music that affect your life from Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at ubnradio.com.
Hi guys, I'm Sunny Chayes, and you are listening and watching, hopefully, to Singing in the Rain with the tagline, The Power of One. I like to remind us about that. So we are doing, I'm sort of dressed in my cool school girl stuff. All is well, everyone, don't worry. One of our guests needs a headphone. Anyway, we will get to that. So I'd like to tell you guys that we are doing, this is the second to the last series or show in the series of Back to Cool School Month. And we are going to be having some incredible guests today. We actually have a trio today. Yay, I love that. We had all music last month, and now we just have a trio of brilliant voices in another way. And we're going to be talking about, you know, kind of breaking up the idea of what is normal, whatever that means for our school system in America, which I'm sure all are in agreement is a little bit broken, and in some cases a lot broken, and how to get it more relevant, how to get it more yummy for kids to learn and want to be in school and want to participate and want to really, really learn, because, you know, all kids really want to learn. So I want to bring on our first guest, but our first guest does not have headphones, so I'm going to ask you to let her borrow it, and then we will figure this out. So our first guest is Dr. Nikki Elliott, and she is a rockin' person. She's a very, very powerful teacher, speaker, inspirer when it comes to children a little bit outside the box, and that's what we like. Let's just forget about the box, for God's sakes. So anyway, I'm just kind of interested in bringing on Dr. Nikki Elliott. Let's just bring her on, John. And we can also cut our music. We don't even need to continue it, because we'll just listen to Nikki's beautiful voice.
Thank you, Sunny, so much for having me with you today.
You're so welcome. So let's just get right to it. You handed me this awesome book, The Intuitive Mother. And I'm gonna tell you something you may not know. There was a guy that a lot of people, a lot of parents were influenced by. His name was Dr. Spock, and he wrote a book many, many years ago, and probably 2.5 generations were raised by his words. Well, I have something to tell you. Simon & Schuster called him one day and said, "Hey, Richard, we need a book about raising kids." And he said, "I don't know anything." Like, "I don't know nothing about raising no kids." And they said, "It doesn't matter. No one will read it. We just need it kind of like on the shelf." So he said, "Fine, fine." So he wrote this book and he threw it out there. And as we all know in this room, the rest is history. So, you know, then there was a guy who came along named D.W. Winnicott, who was a brilliant, brilliant person. He lived in Europe, and he was a psychoanalyst, and he became a pediatrician. And he really, really connected with the doctors and the nurses. And the one thing he said to them was, he toured all over Europe, and he had a lot of things to say. I read about 7 of his books. But the most important thing I think that he said was, stay out of the way of the mother. And this was back in the 50s, 60s. So I love this title, The Intuitive Mother. So enough of my chatting and schooling, you guys. And let's chat, Nikki.
Thank you so much for having me. I absolutely was inspired to write this book because of the quote you just raised, stay out of the way of the mother. What we are seeing in education and so many areas of family life is this kind of frustration with so many mothers being caught up in this supermom syndrome, of feeling like they have to do more, be more, and that their very value in life is being judged by the perfection of their children.
So true.
And so as an educator, I see increasing numbers of children that are being diagnosed autism, ADHD, anxiety, OCD, many different labels. And a lot of the first question that schools are asking parents is, what's happening or what's not happening at home while your child is showing up this way? And so there are high levels of anxiety and depression and confusion around for a lot of moms when it comes to understanding who their children are and what they need and how to navigate this process. Yeah. And in many cases, mothers are being railroaded to make decisions that they wouldn't make if they were allowed to trust their gut or to turn within to their higher power to find out, who is my child? What does my child need? What does my family need? Yeah. And they're being disempowered in many ways to say, if you loved your child, you'd do what we say, because you, mother, can't possibly know what your kid needs. So turn your kid over to us experts. And through this 21-day meditation process that I developed through my own parenting journey, what I'm inviting mothers to do is to claim their birthright as the soul of their families, as the knower of their children, and to connect with their innate higher consciousness and the higher consciousness of their children, to know which doctor to choose, which school is the right choice, which mm-hmm. teacher within a school is the right choice, which food choices, which entertainment choices, because
be
more is not
advocate,
better.
Right?
Yeah, to be the best advocate for who their individual child is, not for what every other mother is doing for their children. And it really is transforming many women in their parenting, in their self-empowerment around parenting. And that trickle-down effect is really helping the children because, as you know, we have many out-of-the-box learners that the traditional model is just not serving them. And if you keep force-feeding a child into this model, you end up with broken children.
Yes, absolutely.
And so it's nothing but an intuitive mother who can sit in the face of the pressure to create these Ivy League-bound children no matter what mm-hmm. and say, no, that's not the path for my child. I can see an amazing, meaningful life for my child that's not necessarily Harvard-bound, and that's okay.
Well, and the Harvard-bound thing and all that is one thing, but also, and also, just back to who is the child, mm-hmm. who am I as a mom, what's going on here in this most delicious, intricate dyad
yes.
that will never be again, never was, and is only here now in this mm-hmm. moment all the time. As a mom myself, I had to, and I went through a lot of different things being a mom, and the time when I felt the most love for myself, I mean, the most peace that was going on in our family mm-hmm. was when I really listened to myself. Mm-hmm. Occasionally there would be people who were, like, I nursed for a long time. Okay, I'm just gonna tell you people. But I just did, because I knew for these two kids that was something that really made sense. Mm-hmm. And it was really, and people were sort of, well, you know, they're gonna be all attached to you and not be able to connect to other people. Well, mm-hmm. actually the opposite was true.
Right.
I mean, when it was time for them to go, and my young son said to me at two, he was like, we were in Santa Fe, it was pouring snow, and you know, but I was still nursing him, just gonna say, and he said to me, he was in the back seat, he said, I need friends. I need to say hi to people. I'll never forget that. And I was like, okay, who do I know? Where can I go right now to get this kid two friends and so we can say hi to people? Put him right in school. And, you know, I was kind of lurking around in the trees making sure he was okay. Or sometimes I would stay a little while and play with the sandbox and stuff just to make sure. But he was off.
Yeah.
So, again, the truth of knowing, like Dr. D.W. Winnicott said, it's like that's where it is that connection with the dyad, with the mom and the child.
Absolutely. And again, when we talk about the brokenness, so to speak, of public education, it's really coming from this overemphasis of standardization and this one size fits all. And the needs that our children are presenting now are so varied, and our teaching staff are so unprepared for children coming in with sensory integration challenges, children that have anxiety, OCD, ADHD, and to push them all down a similar funnel, it really requires mothers and parents in general, I hope dads would become intuitive too, to be able to step up and say, no, we demand something else for our child. And we have the conviction from within that gives us the wherewithal and the guts to stand up against the system for our child.
Absolutely. And the other thing is, and I talked about this last show with Sherry Hardy and Eitan Borzer, and Sherry Hardy is great. She's part of the consortium, which we'll talk about in a minute. I was talking about how also just the system of school is just so antiquated in America. I mean, I went to school in Europe. I went to school in Africa. There are excellent things about all the different places. The one thing that's really true about America, though, is that kids get up way too early mm-hmm. to be at school. Their melatonin is not happening.
Right.
You know, and a 14-year-old kid is not functioning at 7 in the morning, mm-hmm. just no matter what you do. And also getting out of school at 2 o'clock. I mean, we're not picking strawberries or milking cows or whatever after school. We're just not, you know, the kids are just not doing that. So this system is, and then the wooden desk. I mean, come on, really?
Yeah.
And the kids have to sit in the wooden desk. It's this little thing, you know, and be talked to most of the time. And again, luckily in a lot of schools are getting into the idea of interaction and all of that. But, mm-hmm. you know, again, my son got in trouble because he was tapping his pencil. And I found out at our last show, Sherry was talking about that that's actually, with a metronome and with clicking and everything, that's actually what clicks the brain into mm-hmm. gear and allows it. It's kind of like working out. It kind of like makes you jump into gear, mm-hmm. gear. And so, again, that not only the Harvard-bound thing, but also just even functioning at 7 years old in a classroom where it's not really working for the modern human being, yeah. Don't you think?
I agree. And although as an educator and having had the opportunity to watch a lot of charter schools and a lot of innovation in model public schools, many are moving away to more cooperative models, more comprehensive type of approaches that are including mindfulness and yoga and more indoor-outdoor education with a lot of the school gardens and things. It's just that
right.
Many students, especially our most impoverished inner city communities, are the last to have access to this type of education. So,
well, but the public schools still, I mean, the charter schools and the Montessori and the Waldorf and, you know, those kinds of schools are kicking into gear. I'm really, really interested in at some point, sooner than later. I mean, my kids are out of the system, so it kind of, you know, breaks my heart. But I remember when I told my older kids, both my kids, Palmer and Chandler, about COSMIKIDS and what they were planning to do, my 24-year-old said, wah! I wish they thought of that when I was in school.
Yeah.
You know, so, I mean, still the majority of people are in public schools. Mm-hmm. And so, oh, we're gonna just have a nice prayer, take a breath, and hope that some of this can get into the public school, which is the mainstream, mm-hmm. you know, mass situation, right? I don't have the statistics.
It is.
What
typically,
the numbers
about
90%
of students are in public education.
And
settings.
Then, of course, there are the actual private schools. Mm-hmm. So there's private, there's charter, there's, you know, so it's still 90%. So that's a lot of peeps.
Yeah.
That's a lot of peeps.
Yeah.
Speaking of peeps, we have some more peeps here, John. I think we should bring them on, if that's okay with you, Dr. Nikki.
Absolutely.
You can stay with us and we'll just
you.
All chat. We'll chat away here.
Thank
we'll
you.
Jat and chat. A new word. Jat. That's jive and chat. Okay. So, John, let us bring on, when you do the camera thing, are we going to get Dr. Pooch and Aha at the same time?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that's the situation. So Dr. Pooch and Aha are going to come on as soon as John lets them. And I'm just going to briefly say that they are awesome, incredible speakers, educators, and inspirers in a very cool kind of modern way, bringing the concept of health, I mean, come on, to our young people. And they're sort of bypassing the parents a little bit and kind of getting to the kids because that's, of course, our future, and also doing it in a very cool, hip, relevant way. So let's bring the adventures of mustache onto the show, the dynamic duo.
Yeah. All right.
Right. Yeah, we love it.
That was a very, very warm introduction.
As we like to do around here.
That's
well, you
right.
guys deserve it. I'm
Thank
so
you.
Excited. We're all here. The Knights of the Round Table are here.
Yes, I love it. I
with
love
our
it.
With our glasses and our mason jars and all
Absolutely.
Kinds of things.
Absolutely.
I have the coolest one.
You have the coolest one, I will say.
Absolutely,
wow.
right? And it's a mason jar. Too.
And
it's
a
top
mason
one,
jar
right?
all kind of configured. I love it.
Amazing.
So let's see. Aha, go first. You're right next to me, so I'm going to let you jump in here.
Well, you know, we're on an international quest to provide highly potent magnificence through, you know, fun, edutainment. We have created a wonderful children's book series. It's a picture book. It's all in rhyme scheme. It's called The Adventures of Mustache, where Johnny Mustache and his superfood friends go on adventures and learn lifelong healthy habits that they can take with them for the rest of their lives. And so, you know, we started the journey. We're both holistic health coaches. And so we both come from the music industry and through, like, I tour a lot. I'm a DJ, and I tour a lot. And really, it kind of started for me, you know, back in high school when, you know, I first kind of, like, came down with acne. And it kind of, like, really troubled me. I really didn't understand how to deal with it, but I'm having a fast food diet, drinking sodas and candies and all this kind of weird stuff going in my body, not really knowing it tastes good. You know, it was kind of hitting those endorphins that were making me happy, and, you know. And so, you know, lo and behold, I found out that I was eating so much acid and inflammatory foods that, you know, I was really kind of like feeding inflammation on my face. And it was just showing every which and way, and I was the guy on stage.
Talk about in your face,
you
right?
Know? Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah. So, you know, being on stage, I was always, you know, passionate about, you know, performing and being in front of people and interacting. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, as an entertainer, I had to do something, and it kind of turned on one day. My uncle started talking about, what am I eating? I start changing what I'm eating and start supplementing some great superfoods and drinking more water and alkaline and water rather. And, you know, and life changed dramatically. I went from going to see the dermatologist once a week or once a month rather and taking all these topicals and stuff to, you know, a rather, you know, non
invasive sort of life that way.
Yeah, with cystic acne going on every year, you know.
You felt a little better about yourself, I'm just thinking.
To say the least, you know. I mean, I never felt bad about myself. I have to say that, you know, I've seen other, I know how it made me feel on some days, but for the most part, I felt like I took it like a soldier, but I know that, you know, it was rough. It was rough, you know.
Well, you and I were talking about this yesterday on the phone, and about eating well and what that means. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we love our friends, we love our family, we love our children if we have them, we love our just our peeps all around us, and we want the best for them, right? I mean, we just do.
Absolutely.
We just want the best for them.
Absolutely.
And we want the best for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
And I was sharing with you that I was, you know, sort of what I thought was lucky as far as eating, because I could kind of eat anything and I still fit in my jeans and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But I had a little bit of a health challenge, kind of not such so much a scare, but a warning. And so I was advised about eating less inflammatory foods and more mineralizing foods and less demineralizing foods. The truth is, even though I fit in my jeans, I knew I was out of integrity. I'm just saying, I just know I just was.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like I was kind of getting away with something. I just kind of felt almost like I was literally stealing from myself, cheating myself.
Mm-hmm.
And when I got, it was like this wake up call kind of slapped me in the face and kicked me in the butt. And I'm like, okay, yeah, okay, I get it. And when I started eating the way I really knew I should eat, it was like such a feeling of love and being in integrity and being honest with myself. I just can't describe the difference. So I just, you know, share that with you. And I'm not a child, but mm-hmm. I kind of am.
No, absolutely. I mean,
but that made a big difference. And so I'm sure that happened with you.
Food is directly related to how you feel. You know, I kind of like touched on it when I said hitting those endorphins. But, you know, chemical reactions happen in our body all the time. And so when you feed yourself, it breaks down and chemical reactions go off and your body will send signals and let you know how to feel and what to feel. And so if you want to be in integrity with your body and help your body recreate itself, as Deepak Chopra talks about, our body recreating,
absolutely,
you know, so frequently and new cells generating, you want to give your body the best possible organics that it can take in, you know.
Yeah.
And even to that point, like, even more, I'm not a doctor, but I would say with the soil that is going on today and how those minerals have been depleted, we should be looking into more advanced ways of supplementing organics into our food. You know,
that and also plan. Absolutely, and the idea of home gardens and
absolutely
and farmers markets and things like that. You know, just stuff that's close.
Yeah,
you know, so we don't, because we don't. I mean, it also doesn't really make sense. I mean, there's something what people again with kids and the different issues that go on with them as far as. I mean, people get the food sensitivity allergy thing mixed up all the time. But
mm-hmm.
So let's talk about food sensitivity, because that's mostly what happens with people.
Mm-hmm.
What it really is about is that our bodies are not meant to eat, again, talking about strawberries, all year round. Mm-hmm. You know, we're meant to eat them for a couple months and then lay off for nine.
Mm-hmm.
And everything is meant in moderation. You know, when we were hunters and gatherers, we would be with meat for a period of time, then we would mm-hmm. not be with meat.
Mm-hmm.
And we also didn't mix a lot of stuff. It's not like we sat down and had, like, you know, 17 different foods. We had, like, beef for mm-hmm. 3 days, you know, and then
right.
we had cornmeal for, you know. So the idea that we eat more locally would also sort of, if we just really did that, it would force us to just eat apples when they're in season, when they're tasty, when they're delicious, when they're really nutritious, when they've got everything they're meant to have, and then lay off for 9 months and eat whatever's meant to be. Mm-hmm. You know, beets.
The concept of seasons and what maybe an almanac was there for.
Kinda. Yeah, exactly. But you know, yeah, and then, you know, growing our own things, our own basil and, mm-hmm. and like that.
Yeah, I mean, oftentimes we don't really remember how our grandparents, my great grandmother passed away this year at 100, right? When they were living and cooking, it was local food. It was organic farming. Yes. It wasn't like something that the FDA had to approve, because I'm going to look out. I remember one of my uncles telling me that even when they ate, you know, pigs and chickens and things of that nature off the farm, they picked those animals up off the ground and let them kind of cure and cleanse before they even took them to the slaughterhouse, you know? Mm-hmm. And so, I mean, we're holistic health coaches, and we understand that people have bio-individualities today in these modern cities that we live in. We're kind of away from that, you know, touched with nature. We're not grounding. We're not earthing enough, if you will. You walk around barefooted, people think you're kind of crazy almost, you know. But, you know, so living in these cities and these type of environments, we have to really understand how to relearn nutrition and try to get back to local farming or at least the closest things to us. Because if you have these allergies and food sensitivities, I mean, similar to what why honey or bees are good. You know, it's a lot of different studies on how people should eat, but I don't believe that there's one way for everybody to eat in all, you know, because we all have bio-individualities and react differently, you know.
I think the one thing that we can all agree on, and I think it's a really simple one, and that is that, at least for me, you guys are probably younger than me, but my parents' generation was the last generation, in other words, what you're saying, everything was pure. There was no such thing as McDonald's or even Starbucks.
That was a new phenomenon.
I mean, all of that was new. I mean, the idea of having cup holders in your car, I mean, that you know, you didn't have those in cars in the 60s or whatever. Right. So all these kind of just ways of life as well as foods, I mean, there were not preservatives because people hadn't figured that out yet. Mm-hmm. There wasn't Trader Joe's. There wasn't a food in plastic. That just hadn't come around yet, really, until the 70s. So my feeling is just take a breath, and just eat what's real. And, you know, there was this whole conversation some years ago about it. Why are the French, why do they eat all this, you know, cream and all this stuff, and they're so thin? Because they eat real food. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's something that goes on with kids when they're eating plastic food. Mm. You know, like I used to tell my kids when they would see gumballs in a big machine, I would say, "Honey, the joke was, you know, we don't eat food that's older than us." that's one rule we have in the abode here, you know.
Absolutely.
And we
don't,
you know, we don't drink out of plastic bottles. Guys, the water's been in there for a year. Mm-hmm. I'm just telling you. It's been in there for three months minimum to a year. Maybe one of the, like, crystal geyser, if you're kind of close to it, you know, 1 to 3 months. But it's not like it was put in there 2 days ago. So not only is the plastic bad for our environment, the water in is not a health product. Mm-hmm. So please don't give it to your kids, please. Mm-hmm. They're finding the plastic in umbilical cord blood. So, you know, it's happening. So we can just, I think if we just simplify. Mm-hmm. Now let us chat with Dr. Pooch. You're just saying, come on in and come into our party.
Yeah. No, it's such a pleasure to hear this conversation going on. What we need is more food awareness to teach our children that there are other ways of doing things, because ultimately we have to put the power back into their hands. They're gonna be the ones in turn to take care of us. And if we leave them with a bad model, with a I don't care attitude, then that's just what's going to perpetuate. Mm-hmm. And literally, they are the future. And once we come to that realization, we understand that we must empower them with the right tools. And we have to correct our wrongs. So that was the reason for us writing this book, is because you said it in a nice way. We had to bypass the parents. So we had to educate the parents subtly and hold them accountable to the lessons that Johnny Mustache and his superfood friends learn in these stories. So the child then at that house becomes the holistic health coach, or rather Johnny Mustache is the first holistic health coach introduced into the household. And now the child says, well, sugar from nature is always fine. It's only a hazard when sugar is refined. And they start learning these things and applying them in the household. and they hold their parents accountable to what they see, because mm-hmm. that's just how kids learn. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, and also I think that, you know, parents, I mean, we want to, okay, look, sometimes we just need it easy. I'm just going to tell you. Yeah. You know, sometimes we just
yes,
do.
I
and
agree.
That's why, I mean, I never ever thought McDonald's would ever, yeah, get anywhere near me, you know. But then when I had the second baby, I ended up, there were a few drive-through moments. So the thing, though, is to figure out, to actually, you know, kind of re-educate and through the kids and like that, tasty, easy, and affordable. I just wrote those words down when we were talking.
Absolutely.
Because, you know, hey, at the end of the day, that expression I don't really like. But anyway, it's really about that. And it is tasty. Real food is tasty.
Absolutely. And then it's very important how you start. You know, I have two children. And
how old are they?
I have a 5-year-old and I have a 1-year-old.
Aww.
16 months. And so definitely kind of helped inspire me to aspire. But
yeah, I bet.
In the early days when we first start, I mean, like, you have to remember, when we have our most glorious moments with these children, we feed them some of the most horrendous and horrific, you know, so-called treats or whatnot.
Yes.
So what does that do to the psyche? You know, I'm sure you can kind of like speak to that or whatnot. When you couple a birthday or a graduation or a big milestone for these children and advance in life,
sugar.
And it's sugar, 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 sugar. And not even, you didn't even try to go fruits, you went, you know, the syrups and the in the
can I interject one thing there, but do not lose your thought, because I just wrote this down also. When my kids you know, I sent them to school with really like organic everything. My one son told me later that he was actually named health food. Now I have no idea how they knew that the turkey was organic, that the man, I mean, it looked the same, I thought, but somehow kids know these things. And so I went on a field trip one time. This is in Northern California, where, you know, I don't know, you just sort of think maybe things are really organic and granola and all that. And I went, and there were kids that actually had Snickers bars in their lunch, and they had, some people had actual Cokes or, you know, that kind of thing. And my son, we were talking when driving home, and he said, oh, my God, you know, this person and that person is so lucky. And I said, you know what, honey? They're not lucky. See, I don't want to say, you know, the mom doesn't know or whatever. I don't want to
make them feel bad.
Yeah, or, you know, be all judgmental. I said, but they're actually not lucky. I said, that's not about being lucky.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to interject that when you're saying about the celebration, because it does tend to be about sugar.
That's the ultimate kind of like point or slam dunk to that point was, you know, you have to teach the kids early that, you know, for me, I was introducing fruit. If you didn't like the fruit, there's another fruit we can try. If you don't like that one, there's another one. I guarantee you, you're going to like one of these fruits, because they're great. They're great tasting. They're natural sweet. And you're trying to find that type of feeling looking at these candies. Those candies are synthetic versions of what, that's why they name them the fruit flavors. Mm-hmm. They're fruit flavors. They have nothing to do with fruit. So when I actually like had that realization with my daughter, we were like, she's like, but it's strawberry. I'm like, it's not strawberry. There's nothing strawberry about this. They're just saying, they're just calling it strawberry because it's red.
They just got it pink, exactly. And you know? That's scary.
Yeah.
You know, red dye 5, whatever, help.
Right, and your child's running around with a red or blue mouth, and what part of that is okay?
Like, you none.
They can't pick the pen up and crack the pen and put it in their mouth. It would look the same. So, you know, we have to kind of like educate them early on, and the earlier we get to them and teach them, you know, a cleaner methods and cleaner habits to start, they're going to do that. You know, if they don't like to drink water, I guarantee you, try some ice cold water. That's not the best thing for everybody, but I guarantee you on a hot day, your child is going to be thirsty and quenched when they drink some cold water.
And if you throw, and if there are a couple things you can throw in water, like lime, like lemon, like cucumber, and it's like yummy.
It makes it fun, yeah.
Well, the other thing that I noticed when I changed foods was that my palate actually changed. I mean, I actually did not like, okay, like a lot of vegetables.
Absolutely.
I'll just say, I just didn't really like them.
I was there.
And I ate, you know, potato chips and just all this stuff. And then when I cut that out, and I cut out bubbly water. By the way, guys, don't give your kids bubbly water. I found out, you know, I've been drinking it since I was whatever for many years. Okay, it wrecks your teeth. It's not so much the sugar in the bubbles that you know how they always talk about, the dentist says don't drink Coke. It's the bubbles also that work on the enamel. So forget the bubbly water. Mm-hmm. Obviously, fruit juices in the bottle. Let's not be doing that, please.
Mm-hmm. They're in cute little bottles, and they're kind of like, you know, expensive, so you think they're good if you
And they're not. And they're not.
And they don't have any minerals.
And they demineralize. Well, they not only do they demineralize us, which I didn't know that, but I found that out. So it's like since I stopped drinking bubbly water, it's wild. I mean, it's like, but guess what? All that stuff costs money. Mm-hmm. I mean, I really found, I thought, ooh, you know, switching. And I'm talking about this now like I've always eaten junk. I mean, again, when I had kids, I made all their food. I brought a baby grinder with me to every restaurant I made. You know, I mean, there was nothing that went in them that was not totally organic. And so, you know, I ate that way for a while.
You did cloth diapers too?
Oh, totally. I mean, they had wooden toys. I made cotton. They had a cotton cloth, what they called nose cloths, and table, like we just didn't have paper. I just didn't do it. But anyway, back in the day, that was what I absolutely did. And then they kind of rebelled. They would go over to friends' houses, and the first thing they went for was the cereal, like, cupboard.
Hamburger.
But no cereal for some reason. Like, they would go to friends' houses, and they would open it up, and the Lucky Charms, and the Fruit Loops, mm-hmm. and the whatever, and the milk. I mean, it was like, and my friends would laugh. They're like, oh, my God, Palmer is going nuts. I'm like, yeah. Because he gets Oreos and carrot juice at my house. So that's, and diluted carrot juice even, not even full strength. So, you know, back in the day, I was super strict about that stuff. But then, as I say, when I kind of got away from it and then got back to it, the truth is I thought, ooh, it's going to be so much more expensive to eat organically and you know, all that. And the truth is, no.
It's not.
When you cut out that all that the junky stuff, they say it's the outside of the store is the good area, and all that inside with all the Chips Ahoy and the
anything
all that
in a
stuff.
Box or a package.
I would love to speak to that because I always tell people, like, if you think historically, okay, World War One, if you know your history, a lot of soldiers were, you know, dying from malnutrition. You know, they were on the battlefield, they were shooting and banging, but, you know, some of them were succumbing to just malnutrition because they were sending whole foods out there, perishable foods that would die along the way, you know. And, you know, by World War II, if you will, just going faster, I guess the powers that be started to realize how to preserve foods, and that's when the canning and the preserving of the food started to come. And so as they started shipping these preserved foods to everybody, the foods lasted longer, the soldiers were stronger, and they held up. But then look at our degenerative disease rates post-World War II and the sky rise of that, post-high fructose corn syrup and all of these other heavy metals that we're seeing in there. And I mean, where did autism come from?
Yeah.
You know, like where did, like,
Alzheimer's. I mean, that's the,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, a direct correlation, I believe.
Yeah, it's like this stuff just came on the scene, like, and now it's the biggest thing. And I mean, I just... We have to look at what's in front of us and look at what the food science has how that has changed, and our Franken foods that are on the marketplace that just look cool and taste cool.
Or the things that even say, and again, I feel like we're just doing kind of an education on food, but things that say natural, parents, don't just read further. Because natural does not necessarily mean good for you.
Right. That's what I was going to touch on. There's a whole marketing right now, and that's probably what was happening to your kids because they were watching TV. I don't know if you expose them to TV in the household, but any children's cartoons or children programming, they really? Are getting programmed to want the sugary snacks. Mm-hmm. And they go cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, you know, all of a sudden
the
when they
run.
Exactly. It's very ingenious methods. Even right now, we'll see it with the Snickers bar. We'll have adults thinking that that's a suitable lunch because.
Not going anywhere for a while?
Because it satisfies your hunger.
Mm-hmm. Right. It has just peanuts in it, which
it
are actually not good for you, by the way. But anyway.
Right. Right. Probably GMO peanuts too, you know, right. and a lot of synthetic sugar, and yeah, it's definitely programming. It's interesting. I mean, that's a whole conversation in itself. Just the marketing, the indiscriminate marketing to children, and how that knack factor kind of like hits the home.
Exactly. You know? So I love the fact that in front of me right now I have all these books. I have one called The Intuitive Mother, which I absolutely love. And Dr. Nikki, we're going to talk a little bit more about that. Sugar from nature is always fine. Mm-hmm. I love this. Mm-hmm. And then I also have this book that I just brought in because I want to share with you guys this book because I think it just says what it is. For you guys who are old enough to remember Sandy Gooch and Mrs. Gooch's that ended up being bought by Whole Foods and all of that. But in the back in the day, Sandy Gooch really created a store that was completely safe. I mean, you could go into that store. You didn't even have to read labels. She did all the work for you. Now I call Whole Foods Wholesome Foods. It's like, you know, but this is called If You Love Me, Don't Feed Me Junk.
I love that title.
So back to Dr. Nikki, when you're talking about, you know, the integrity and connecting with the child and knowing what your child is. And we're kind of blah-blahing about all the different things. So I want you to weigh in here a little bit.
Well, I'm hearing the conversation and appreciating it from my perspective as an educator and an energy therapist. And what I am seeing when people are bringing their children to me with ADHD and anxiety and a lot of conditions like that are the demineralization in the child. We also work with the biology of behavior. And so while I'm not a health practitioner, I do refer to holistic doctors, DOs, and naturopathic doctors when I can see energetically in the child patterns in the gut. So a lot of people think that behavior and mental health issues and even learning challenges start in the brain, but they don't. They start in the gut. So when there's a lot of dysbiosis, I can feel energetically in a child when their probiotics, their beneficial bacteria, are depleted. And so a lot of the neurotransmitters that we need to be able to attend and learn are helped, are supported by healthy bacteria flora and also the villi that are able to absorb the nutrients from the body. And so again, energetically, we can see when that's missing from a child. So,
and do you see it often?
I see it often, especially when I work with what we call empathic intuitive children, children who absorb the energy of other people in their environment. Some that are physically empathic, meaning they could feel the headaches or knee pains or physical symptoms of people in the environment, as well as children who can feel the emotions. And so we make assumptions about why a child is not behaving or not attending or learning or why there is dyslexia or letter reversals. But a lot of those instances in the learning are food sensitivities or issues with malabsorption. So there's some great research. One woman, Diane Kraft, has developed a wonderful program that I would recommend to parents, to your audience. It's called The Biology of Behavior. And she talks about how everything going on in the gut is reflective in food allergies, behavior issues, aggression outbursts, as well as what appears to be learning disabilities that can be reversed by changing the diet. So, and there's another program we recommend highly in our practice called the Gut and Psychology Syndrome. It's the GAPS diet by Dr. Natasha McDaniel Campbell McBride, I'm sorry. And again, it looks completely at dysbiosis and how the things that we have fed our children affect the ecology of the gut, and which in turn affect mood, learning, and behavior. So she's resolving asthma, ADHD, dyslexia, all different manners. Even some autistic behaviors are reversing by looking at the condition of the gut. So we can help balance that energetically. It affects the nervous system as well as brain functioning. So
And mood,
absolutely.
Mood and obviously focus.
So with the combination of energy therapy, with dietary changes, we've seen tremendous progress in many children actually being taken off of psychotropic medication for managing mood and behavior.
You know, the thing about kids is that they're in the beginning of their life. Mm-hmm. They're starting out, you know, this game of life.
Right.
And when they come into school, it's one of the first places where kids are really like, you know, they're all loved up at home and stuff, and the grandparents love them, hopefully. I'm talking about, you know, the ideal. They come into school, though, and it's kind of a level playing field. It's like, okay, what's up? How we're doing? What's, you know, am I going to be sports? Am I going to be the cute one? Am I going to be whatever? And it's where a lot of the identity starts, you know, breaking out and coming together and all that. And and so much of self-esteem, it ends up being kind of, again, a dyad. It's like however they're doing, then they get that reaction from the teacher, which feeds their self-esteem and their motivation to do better, which, you know, it's that loop that's a good loop if they get to be in that good loop. Mm-hmm. And that continues usually. And, you know, you see most people who do well in school, they kind of started out well and they just kind of keep going on that track. Or maybe somebody who starts out like that and then maybe in junior high or in fifth grade or something happens, there's a divorce in the family or whatever disrupts that, and they start getting, and the loop starts going the other way. Mm-hmm. So the thing that we're really looking at too, and I want you guys to talk about a little bit as well, is that it is really important to pay attention to that stuff super early, because if they get into that good loop, it's a good loop. And if they don't, it's really hard to get out of it, yeah. Right? Do you guys yeah. know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, absolutely. I agree. I think definitely education is more than reading, writing, and arithmetic. As holistic health coaches, we look at a person's environment. We look at their home situation. It's very telling. Some of my earliest jobs were working with children with special needs, and it was very interesting what I kind of sensed just on an intuitive level, what was going on with the child. When I met their parents, everything seemed to make sense. And so that's where our whole philosophy of re-educating the parent comes from. A lot of, let's just say that, I don't want to speak too much on that, but a lot of the issues do come from the home environment, I believe, and how that child from a seedling was nurtured, mm-hmm. watered, how often they were right. watered, how, you know, and it this speaks to life in general. If you're aware, I'm sure you guys are aware, everything is conscious, mm-hmm. you know, so the universe responds, plants respond to us, the water responds to our thoughts, and what you guys were talking about earlier.
And our feelings.
Our feelings, yes, whether they're spoken or not. And we have more, I believe it's neuron endings in our nerve endings in our gut mm-hmm. than in our brain.
Yes.
So there's more.
Yes, Dr. Nikki's saying yes.
Yeah, she's confirming that. So
she's concurring.
There's a lot to say about, and it's such a great title once again, the intuitive mother. There's so much to say about imagination and the intuitiveness of children. They just latch onto things and go with the moment mm-hmm, mm-hmm. because they're in the essence of what that is. And either we cut that off and say, okay, enough with this, welcome to the real world, mm-hmm. or we nurture that and it develops and grows.
And they can absolutely. Shift. Yeah. That's the other thing. I mean, absolutely. We can really start that page again yeah. if we need to. So anybody listening who has a 5-year-old or an 8-year-old, you know, we used to also think with the brain development that it stopped, or the personality development or the character development mm-hmm. was 5. Well, we know that's kind of true, but it also shifts. And we used mm-hmm. to think the brain stopped sort of growing or developing. It used to be 16, then 18, then 21, then 25. And now we know mm-hmm. with the new studies mm-hmm. that, hey, we can learn new languages and learn how to dance and do whatever at
absolutely.
94.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So
I was
keep
say.
It rolling.
Yeah,
keep
I was
it rolling,
say,
people.
If you're a parent and you're done learning and you know everything, then you know, you might as well go jump in your casket, because you're doing your children a disservice if you have them, because, you know, we have to trust in our children and actually listen to them and give them an opportunity to express themselves, not in fear, mm-hmm. not in doubt, not in worry of what somebody else is going to think or judge them and say, you know, back to them, versus letting them freely express themselves, and you might learn something. You know?
Well, and what I just wrote down also, which I want to say to parents, because again, being one, and you're a new parent, I'm sort of an older parent, is that there can be a lot of sort of guilt or feelings about, damn, you know, I wish I had done that or this mm-hmm. or, you know, whatever. And the truth is, it's always a new day. And I realize that even with having older kids, that, yeah. I mean, luckily they're in pretty good shape, but I definitely have my days or moments of tearful, you know, nights and like, ugh. Mm-hmm. And yet I know what you're saying. I appreciate you saying that, because that just triggered that feeling in me that, you know what, it's always a new day. And we will always be parents no matter what, no matter how, you know, when I'm 80 and my kid is, you know, 60 or 40 or
right,
whatever,
exactly.
you know, it always can be recreated. New love, new devotion, new support, new yumminess can shift anytime. So parents, you know, we can keep it fresh too.
Yeah, my great grandmother used to always tell me, she said, when are you gonna come back and see me? I said, I'm coming tomorrow and see. She said, nope, tomorrow is a day that will never come. You come see me now.
You know? I like that.
So you have to stay right now, because tomorrow is, you know, a mystery and yesterday is history. You have to stay right in the now of the moment. You
I
know?
Like that.
I like that.
Now, I know that we're kind of getting, you know, we've just been chatting away here, and I just want to make sure that we're getting to everything that we want to get to. And I want to send some love out to Judy Julin, and who brought us all together here today.
Yes, Judy.
Thank you.
We love you, Judy.
Thank you, Judy.
You know, we had a latte at our little place that we get together, and we had this idea of doing, you know, I was whining about school, and she's rocking COSMIKIDS and all kinds of awesome things that she's doing. And it was like, why don't we bring the idea of having our peeps out there, my peeps out there, learn from all of you sages about what new ways can be, you know, how we can shake up this way of educating and inspiring and raising our children and ourselves through our children and all that, like you guys have so beautifully put out. So in the last few minutes, I want to make sure that we talk about the consortium just a little bit and anything that you guys want to talk about that is promotion time.
Okay. Well, we definitely want to give a shout out to the consortium, and it's a wonderful group of individuals from a lot of different disciplines that have come together under one umbrella to, you know, just move the world, you know, and create that shift and change that we want to see. So I'm, you know, ecstatic about it. When she called me and told me what she was doing, I was really, really moved and excited to be considered as a founding member, you know. So.
Yeah. And you, Dr. Nikki?
So Judy and I had an opportunity to meet through Hunter School, which I would like to give a shout out to Lori Ferris.
Yes, and Tom Hartman.
And she and I had the chance to meet because Lori and I have been discussing bringing energy work to Hunter School and having a referral partnership so that families who can't have a school environment, a therapeutic school environment that involves energy work like Hunter does, could customize that in their homes.
Beautiful. Nice.
So I was really honored to be invited as a founding member to bring the voice of energy therapy and to bring it into the mainstream, because we do bring it into schools. I give a shout out to Reverend Leon Campbell at Agape.
Reverend Leon, he's been on here about five times. We love him.
So the thing that I love about this and having the chance to meet you all today is that this is a global effort to bring new thought education to the mainstream.
Yes. Yay.
So these ideas of holistic living, of energy therapy, of energetic mindfulness, COSMIKIDS, you know, the idea of nurturing intuitive and psychically gifted children and making it, I brush my teeth, I tie my shoes, and I talk to my angels. What's next? You know?
Yeah.
So just to embrace all of who we are and all of the gifts that our children have, leaving nothing hidden in our pockets, nothing under the table, to really just change the way we involve consciousness. We talk about educating mind, body, and spirit, but we have no collective conversation of what our secular spirituality looks like. Mm-hmm. And how we can all embrace our spiritual selves, our sacredness in collective shared space, regardless of our individual beliefs. And I think that the New Thought Education Consortium will really advance that conversation in all disciplines, in all environments where our children grow and where our families exist. Mm-hmm. And so I'm excited to be a part of that work.
Yay. And again, I want to send a shout out to The Intuitive Mother, which is your awesome
thank
book.
Thank you. Yes.
And now Dr. Pooch.
Yes. I also wanted to thank you very much. I also wanted to send a shout out to Dave Rodriguez, who we met through Judy Julin doing COSMIKIDS. We're actually shooting a reel for
not a reel. We shot 25 episodes for COSMIKIDS. And it was amazing. It was a great thing.
It was a great experience. But unfortunately, the illustrator of our book is suffering from cancer right now, and he's
stage four cancer.
So we're sending all our love to him and healing vibes out to him and his family. Hope that everything will be good for him.
Yes. Whoa. The adventures of Mustache.
Yes. And also, we work with giving back. We believe in giving back, and we partner with a nonprofit organization called LifeDriven.org, and we donate trips to Disneyland or just fun adventures to kids that are ill with cancer, some terminally ill, some just within the battle. Mm-hmm. And if anybody out there would like to donate, just log on to lifedriven.org. Mm-hmm. And
beautiful.
You can donate. We can donate at this point, we want to donate books to different schools so we can bring in that health curriculum to the actual schools.
Absolutely. Whoa, I know some schools. We'll be talking.
Absolutely. Yeah,
absolutely. And guys, you know, you can get to me at sunnychase@gmail.com. And if you have any thoughts or ideas about any of these guests and how you can play with us, definitely do that, because that's the whole point of this. It's like you guys are masters and sages in what you're doing, and hopefully people out there are listening and inspired and can reach and in your communities to do what you're doing and bring it farther and bring it deeper. And again, all parents know today is a new day. God, that like chokes me up, because we always have the opportunity to shift it, even though we thought, you know, it wasn't going so well. It can always be new. And how are we doing? Are we about out of time? Okay, we have one more minute. So everybody, okay, go, Dr. Nikki.
If I can, I'd love to invite your guests, your listening audience, to join me. I'm offering a free webinar next week. So for parents who would like to understand their highly sensitive children, I'm offering a free webinar on Tuesday, September 30th. And if you have any practitioners, teachers, mental health professionals that want to understand how to support empathic, intuitive, and psychically sensitive children, that webinar will be Thursday, October 2nd, and you can visit my website, www.innerlightsanctuary.com, and click on the events page and register for the free webinar. So I'd like to offer that to all your listeners.
Thank you so much. Absolutely. Well, guys, I want to thank you for everything that you do. It's just been an absolute pleasure for me to be with you guys today. And again, remember, everybody, we do have the power of one. And this is Sunny Chayes singing in the rain. Boy, we've covered the whole end. Yeah. Dr. Nikki, Dr. Pooch, and Aha have all been with me today. And Judy Julin in spirit somewhere. Yes, and remember, we always make a difference, no matter, even if we don't think we do. So do something, surprise yourself today, and do some awesome thing. And until next time, this is Sunny and Sing in the Rain. Bye.
Bye, guys.
In the future, talk radio will actually educate, inspire, and make you think. The future is now. Topics and music that affect your life from Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at ubnradio.com.